Hey, Harley here. What's up? What's up? Welcome back to Film Strut. Today, we're going to be counting down the top 15 killer guitar riffs that I can actually play. And they're also really cool. Air Guitar Central. At number 15, we have an artist that was so inspirational to so many other artists that made it so big. But in America, he's not really that known compared to the UK, where he's from, where he was very, very big, playing stadiums all over the magazines. He was like a true pop artist. Actually, Ringo Starr made a whole movie about him. Robert Palmer turned one of his songs, Bang a Gong, into a massive hit here in the States, but that wasn't until the 80s. We, as a band, Closer, used to pore over this album when we were recording in Sausalito, and our producer, Ed Buller, made us listen to this artist all the time. At number 15, my favorites, check it out. Number 14, we got an artist that just, this dude never ages. I mean, he's got like the six pack, he has the house in Brazil, the ranch. You know, he's like, yeah, I'm just gonna go down there and we're just gonna chill and vibe and pick fruit off the land and eat it. And then my guitar player sleeping in the next room, he's having some wine, but then we're gonna go and rehearse in the backyard. Oh, what an amazing life. This guy, his influences are like Hendrix to like Curtis Mayfield to like Sly and the Family Stone to the Beatles. He actually owns the board that the Beatles recorded Sgt. Pepper on and all their stuff actually. Number 14, check it out. This next one, crazy enough to snort a line of ants just to outdo Motley Crue on a bet. One of the coolest cassette tapes I ever owned. I burned out both sides. I listened to it so much when I used to stay at my grandmother's when I was a teenager. Love this one. Killer riff, number 12. Check it out because it's bad. Bad. This next one is known as one of the coolest riffs of the 90s, and it's from a band that didn't really have any other hits, but this song is supposed to be about everything from like a dude hooking up with a girl to like actually going all the way to like a race car driver. I think every guitar player, you know, jams this riff when he's like playing at Sam Ash or something. That's the worst, when you're at Sam Ash and you have 17 people playing a bad version of Stairway to Heaven. Someone's playing this one in the back. And number 13, he's going up. Number 11, we have a band and a riff that is so instantly recognizable that Bill Gates gave them $14 million to use it in his first computer commercial. The odd thing is, and this is inspirational sometimes, people have songs laying around for years and they don't do anything with them. This one was laying around because Keith and Mick couldn't get along enough to sit down in a room and write, but they wanted the tour. So their engineer, Chris Kimsey, was like, I'll just compile some stuff that you guys had laying around for like the past 5 years. Oh, here's one. I think it was called Never Stop at first. But anyway, here it is. This one goes to 11. I'm sure Mick would really approve of my British accent. Number 10, my favorite number in the world, because something about 10, it's like anything that's in the top 10 is the shiznik. So now we're getting into the meat of the potato. The meat and potatoes. This song was written when this band took a break from recording their album in New York City, and they went to Times Square and they heard someone on the movie screen say, this next one is a tune that I always play when I go to Sam Ash, and it's hilarious and everyone knows it, but these songs are actually really well written, and I am going to do a segment on this actual movie, because how many times I've been talking with a musician friend and you start humming the songs and humming the lyrics, and it's like, you're like, wow, that was really interesting and funny as hell, and it's all just like freaking killer, and I love this riff. Tonight. All right, at number 8, I forget what it was for. This next artist, I'm gonna play the riff and I'm gonna write it on the little corner there, because I've heard that they do not like when people talk about their music. We want to let people know like how cool this stuff is. Anyway, in at lucky number 7, we have the number 6, a band that used to open their sets with this tune because it was a crowd favorite, and it's one of the baddest riffs ever written. Rumor has it that when Eddie Van Halen heard this song live in 1972, it inspired him to do his tapping technique, knocking people's socks off, cutting heads off. Whatever he was doing, it was working. This, it's one of the baddest riffs ever. This next group comes from the musical hotbed known as Manchester, England. That was not a good British accent. Manchester. I don't know what's in the water there, or they're just so extremely bored from the bad weather that they become the great rock and roll bands that we all know and love. Whatever it is, I love them all. Even though they never really broke here. I mean, you know, they have an underground following. I mean, you know, in the 80s, they had a big following here, but it was like, you know, in England, you know, it was like the Beatles. But here it was like kind of like, if you're in the know and you're like in college, then yeah, man, I like this band. It's super cool. Anyway, this riff, when I heard it, it made my big toe shoot up in my boot. We're almost at the top 5. Next group, guitar player, one of the biggest selling bands ever, did his own thing. This riff is one of the most funky and memorable. A laka a lot. And if you don't like it, you're crazy. Do you wanna know why? Because it's so powerful that you just like, you can't help but just be like, leave it on. Number 4. next one. You know, like when you go to a concert and everyone's waiting, you're like having your drink, you're like, yeah, man, I can't wait till they come on. Like you're just talking and like, you know, you're sitting there and the lights are already like half, you know, mass and everyone's just talking, like, yeah, it's Jim. Yeah, when did he come? Oh my God, he's here. And all of a sudden the lights dim just a little bit more and this riff starts and the beach ball's going. You're, ah! Everyone screamed a little bit more, but the band's not coming out yet. It's always this song. And this is number two. This next one, this band has already appeared on the list, but I couldn't help it. They have too many great riffs to leave this one off. And this is one of the most bluesy, most like ballsy as all get out riffs. When this band came out, they were panned by the critics as a blues ripoff. But it didn't matter because they rose to fame. They skyrocketed to fame so fast, fans thought that they made a pact with the devil and it just added to their mystique and mystery. But the riff is cool as all get out. Here it is. We made it. This one, I had to put it here, even though it didn't really get to number one in the charts back in the day. As memorable and as influential that it is, which is crazy, because I don't think there's a person in the world that doesn't know this riff. Not one, well maybe. I mean, if you're in the jungles of the Amazon and there's certain tribes that don't have any contact with the outside world, then maybe. But besides that, it's incredible. It's the most influential rock and roll god history. And it only peaked at number 67 on the Billboard Hot 100. I don't get it. But today, it's number one, number one. Click the subscribe button, hit the little bell icon so that you're notified when I post a new video. I love that. When I ring that little bell, you know, I didn't even know that till like a month ago. You ring that little bell and then you're sitting there like bored, flipping through your phone and it's like, oh, he's talking about this and that. And I'm like, let me go see what he's talking about because I have an opinion on that. Hit the subscribe, ring the bell, and I'll talk to you soon. Later.